Turn with me to the Gospel of John. We want to look at...
Can you just read this word, please?
And the Word was God. The Word was God. Okay, if you'll notice, actually, and it says the Word was God. There are no new words in that. We've discovered those, all those words before. And in the beginning was the Word was with God. So all the words are there, but there's a different order, and it is the Word was God. So we're not discovering new words and new realities behind new words. We're discovering these words as you link them together, and the Word was God. All right, we were talking last class about the Scriptures and the Word of God. And so let me read a little bit. It's only the Spirit that can reveal the eternal Word in the letter. Okay, this is called the letter, okay? And there is the letter and the Spirit, okay? And you can just read this and, you know, and not see the Spirit behind it. And you can condemn everybody and condemn yourself, or you can see the Spirit behind it and become one with Christ, because he that is joined to the Lord is one Spirit. All right, so that's why we say it's the Spirit that reveals the eternal Word in the letter. The revelation of Christ comes only in the Scriptures. Now, it doesn't come only when in the Scriptures. But let me tell you something. The Word, it is the Word of God that has gotten in you that reveals Christ. It is the Scripture, because it is, he is the Word of God. I mean, you can't see Jesus without the Word. It doesn't matter how much you read. If you go to the Scripture and see anything but Christ, then you have handled the Word of God deceitfully. How can you be in the Word and not see Christ, who literally is the Word? He's the Word. The Word was God. The Word was God. He is the Word. The Word was God. Went to the Scripture. Didn't see the Word. Saw something else. Got some comfort. Used the Word of God deceitfully. You know. How can you go to the Word and not see the Word? Okay?
Why is it intended word by deceitfully? Are you deceiving yourself?
That's a good question. Now, let me take the next step. And that is, you don't automatically see the Word by reading the Scriptures, so it's okay to go to the Scriptures and just read the Scriptures, even if you don't see the Word. But if your motivation is not to see Jesus, I believe you're wrong. This word in John 5:39, Jesus says, you search the Scriptures, talking to the Pharisees, you search the Scriptures, for in them you think you have eternal life. But there they would testify me. You're missing me because your motive is there to go and get comfort or be smarter than somebody else or answer somebody's, you know, deal. Okay. If witnessing and sharing the Lord with people on the streets is a matter of figuring out everybody's question and then coming up with an answer, I mean, we don't really need Jesus. Good, solid education in those days. But I'll tell you, the thing that disarms or that just will take the sting out of the enemy is when the answer is Christ. Now, I cannot tell you what I'm talking about when I say that, other than I can tell you, you know, I see them bringing this, the Scripture says that this woman, we caught her in adultery, the Scripture says she needs to be stoned. And Jesus says, here's the Word of God. You that are without sin, cast the first stone. They all walked up. That's what I mean. I can't tell you, but I can tell you when the Word comes forth, it's either powerful or disarming or all the things that it is. A multiplicity of ways that it can affect you, but it is powerful. So, know the Scriptures, but let your motive be, I'm knowing the Scriptures that I might know the Word.
We're so used to good versus evil, and the Word is neither the tree of life. So it's so different, because people who witness you come from good versus evil. You know, sinners are, that's their territory, you know, good and evil. But said, I hate going to church, and on and on and on. And I said, well, even if you don't want to do this, you still want to do. And just, you know, that's so simple to say, and he actually said that in my spirit, but somehow the Lord came to that and just really affected me, and he could see the spirit living with it. Because it wasn't getting back to, well, Jesus is good, and church is good, it was just the ministry of the Lord. And he just said, anyway, I don't think they were going to do. And that's totally the need of duty. And so now I'm going to get to the end. It just really cool to see that word.
I mentioned this Sunday night, most of the ones here because you're coming back from San Antonio, but I mentioned this, talking to this Baptist kid, you know, or he was talking to this kid, and he says, I tried that, you know. And he said, no, I don't think I'm interested, you know, but, and I said, what do you mean you tried it? He said, I tried it, you know. I said, grow up Baptist or whatever? And he said, yeah. And I said, you know, Baptist church is based on John the Baptist. You know, that's the Baptist and the baptism and the baptism going on. All that goes back to John the Baptist, you know. And they were right, you know, because they would tell you all this stuff. You know, John came and he said, repent, you know, repent. And so you hear all these Christians come up to you and go, accept Jesus, repent. You know, you've heard that a million times, and that's what you're used to. And you know, but I said, I got good news for you. John had another part of his message, and that was, there's one coming after me that is preferred before me, and this one is everything. I'm not even worthy, nor is the Baptist movement or anybody else under this thing worth. This guy is it. And what the Baptist failed to tell you is the full message. You only got half the message, and I want to tell you about the other half. It's life, and we're one with Jesus, and he's trying to form a body, which is the new man, and doesn't just throw out stuff, you know what I mean? Which is not what you hear at the Baptist church. You know. And he expected to hear the message of John the Baptist, because that's what he heard. Repent, shape up, da-da-da-da. You know. And I said, oh, you didn't even get the full, you know, you claim you were a follower of John, but you didn't get the full message of John. He has something that's totally other coming after him. Because he just sat as a little kid in the Baptist church, and he didn't want that. And I said, you know, man, there's a lot more. You know, well, you know, I mean, he didn't fall on his knees and accept Jesus right there, but he heard that there was something other than what he thought was Jesus. I said, that wasn't Jesus. That was John, the ministry of John the Baptist that you were pretty much familiar with. But I said, John, really, his best part of his message is that there's something totally other than all of this. He said, I'm not even in. I got a decrease. He said, so being joined with him wasn't it. Being joined with Jesus is where it's at. The Lord knows how to start working on you, getting through. You know, and you're like, oh, well, I sure wasn't expecting that kind of an answer. All right, so let's see. To see the Word is to understand what is preferred before us. What's that? That's the next one. We must search the Scriptures for the Word, the total thought and concept of God. We must search the Scriptures for the total thought and concept of God. Logos, the Word. The word logos means the total thought and concept. We must see the Word. Jesus is the Word. He is the total thought concept of God. The total concept is with God as a plan. And the total concept of God was God, because it's Christ. In the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God. The Word was God. The ability to quote Scriptures means very little. The Pharisees searched the Scriptures, but never saw in them the total thought and concept of God. You can quote Scriptures, but you cannot quote the Word, for it is a person. You can quote what the Word said, but you can't quote the Word. The Scriptures are not a person, but only a vehicle used to reveal the person. We do not grow spiritually by learning Scripture, but by learning Christ's life. That's a toughie, but that's the truth. Because the scriptures are not spirit until they become Christ. Jesus said, my words I speak unto you are spirit and life. You're not really growing spiritually. You may be gaining a ground from which the Spirit of God can reveal Christ in your spirit, whereby spirit you will lead. You are changing. But just learning scriptures, you're not growing spiritually. But you are laying the best foundation that you possibly can to be able to grow spiritually. But don't misinterpret the two, because the Pharisees knew the scriptures back and forward. They weren't too spiritual. So the Bible becomes the Word of God when we see Jesus there. Right? If we have a question about how to live for God or do something, we don't just turn and see what the Bible has to say about it. If we have a question about how to live for God or how to do something, we don't just see what the Bible has to say about it. Let's go to the Koran. Let's go to the Bible. It's got good, solid wisdom on how to approach life. No. Jesus said, you search the scriptures, but they testify me. You're kind of missing the point, boys. Since the Word was God, that says what I want to say. Since the Word was God, then only the living Word can fulfill the written Word. Since the Word was God, the Word was God, was with God, the Word was God. Since the Word was God, only the living Word can fulfill the written Word. This is why you have such a hard time fulfilling what the words, the scripture says. Because only the living Word can fulfill the written Word. That's why we need precious Jesus. That's why it all begins with Jesus said, forget that, forget this, you must be born again. You've got to receive a new seed. Being born again, incorruptible seed, by the Word of God which liveth. That's the first one. Being born again, not of corruptible seed, but of incorruptible, by the Word of God which liveth. The living Word can fulfill the written Word. You cannot, but you can try. You fail, then go back and cry out for Jesus. Oh, but I got Jesus. Jesus, help me, help me, help me. See, we're praying wrong. He says, okay, I'll help you, but there's only so much help he can give you because you can't tell him. No care how much help he gives you, you're not able. So quit praying, help me. Say, God, kill me, kill me. Actually, let me see the cross. I'm dead. You know what I mean? I want to know that I'm dead. Let me see that I'm dead so that Christ, your Son, Father, can live in me. Not help me. As long as you're praying, help me. You know. Now, if it's help me, help get the devil off my back long enough where I get to work, or, you know what I mean? I mean, there's a place for that. But, I mean, don't misunderstand that and take it too far. But on the other hand, don't think it's you and God. The work of God is to make you better. The work of God is to conform to his Son. Or to conform to his Son. Sure.
Yeah, in prayers like that, it's almost kind of like you make a division between your Christ and you separate yourself.
Yeah. Absolutely.
Because it's not God helping you, because if you're one with Christ, it's not God helping you, you're being one with Christ. But, you know, and as I started to see the difference between identity and being in Christ, and now you're saying all these other things, it's kind of like it's kind of like being turned back into other things like what this is saying here. But it's a real funny way of looking at it, man.
But you know what's cool about it? That is a sign that your mind is being renewed when that begins to happen. It's like Spanish. Pretty soon you begin to dream and think in Spanish, and then you're going, I think I'm getting it. This is another realm, and it's another mind. It's another way of thinking. And most of us still have that old mentality. It is so easy for us to separate ourselves from Christ and to, you know, I need you, Jesus, instead of he's your life, you're dead. You know, probably couldn't find it, but there was a great sentence we read a couple of days ago when we had in class about his, you know, why seek direction from him about our life? He is our life. And you know, why go to the Word for direction for me? He is the Word. He is the direction. But there's no way to explain it. I mean, you can preach it, you can say it, you can change the terminology, you can do all kinds of stuff. You bring in more people to teach, you can do whatever you want to do. But until the Spirit of God, and but see, even when I say that, see, because the Bible says when the heart turns to the Lord, then we sing. You know, there's a veil, but when the heart turns to the Lord, but see, our mind turns to the Lord, and our emotions sometimes, when we get really down, our emotions turn to the Lord. But when the heart says, when it becomes, our heart's part of our spirit, not our mind's part of our soul. When our heart gets this determination that I, you know, the heart, even the terminology heart, is the very center of what you are. When the center of what you are says, I turn to you, then you go to the scriptures and you see Jesus and you're changed into that same image because that's what you identify.
Well, you know, it's kind of like what you were talking earlier about when Paul was saying they're so surprised that they were so soon removed from Christ. I always read that as still being separate from Christ, and the way that they remove themselves from Christ is that they remove themselves from being Christians or doing the Christian thing as a work.
Yeah.
But what he's saying is that he was so surprised that he saw, again, he saw the bricks in the wall as being the wall, and they actually removed themselves from the wall so it's no longer the wall. And it's identity. They removed themselves from realizing that they were in Christ, going to another form of what they considered was the gospel.
There are so many little parts to this that's important. One is, and there's some book that I wrote, I don't know if I've ever put it out, there's a top, one of the chapters is called The Greatness of Christ, if I'm sounding weird, anybody that would know. I believe there needs to be this understanding of the vast, he's Alpha and Omega, it just pales this But you can still remain separate, see. So there has to be a revelation of the greatness of Christ. Then there has to be a revelation of the oneness of Christ. You know, that in all, because, you know, like John said, I mean, the words, none will come and he is preferred before me. He is greater than all. I'm not even worthy. And that's good. That puts you in a position that you are ready to be identified in him. Been brought that he is so great, and see, it's there's so much to this because part of the bringing down is that circumstances have been one that you see your wretchedness through the fact that when I do good, I don't call this. That's part of it, but another part of it begins to be that you see, maybe I'm just talking my experience, but I began to see that. This was his beloved son. Talking about Jesus, in her, he was well pleased. In her, you know. And that the son was preferred before me, and that the son was all to the father. And then I see my wretchedness through. When I would do good, I don't. And when I want to, all my old days. Plus this contrast. See, there's two contrasts. There's one that circumstantially just showing me I can't do it. I'm a failure. Second one is the contrast of the heart of the Father toward his Son and the greatness of Christ in this whole thing. It brings you to this place where you just go, you know, then you're presented with this way out. Because, I mean, it's pretty dark to really realize how nothing you are this way, then seeing the old man you know, the scriptures talk about the vastness of the depth of the possibilities through that, then seeing how great Christ is, you can just, you know what I mean? But then, the door of faith, Galatians chapter 3, the door of faith is presented. You're in him, you're accepted in him, all that he is, you are, and, you know, this is your one. And you go, yes! You know, you grab it and you do not ever want to let go. So, but, you know, I've always hesitated to get into too much detail sharing those things. Because we'll go scurrying around trying to figure it out. I think a heart towards God, well, I think a heart towards God will stumble across the right path in the sense that God will lead you to realize the vastness of Christ. Oh, wretched man that I am, seeing in Adam and the fullness of the wretchedness of that, and all that, whether I did it or not, I'm one with that, and I'm capable of it. Oh, God, help me. You know what I mean? And then he opens your eyes, and, you know, but if you spell it out too much, that's why I don't think it's spelled out in Scriptures the way we want. Because if it's spelled out too much, we're going to think we're going to go search out God. Now, it didn't say we shouldn't search for God, but you can't search out God. He's unsearchable. You can search, if he opens your eyes, then you'll see.
No, that verse in Corinthians, if you receive something, why do you act like you haven't received it? I can't remember exactly the way it goes, but that's true, because in all of my trying to see the Lord, what little I've seen didn't come from all of my trying to see the Lord.
Right.
It's something that I received, and you can't act as if you haven't received it, as if it's something that you did yourself.
And then there's that whole side, the only stability you've got to make that full bridge is the grace of God. You just believe it. You have to believe it. There's no choice. If you're really in that place, there is no choice. I mean, it's either the grace of God or nothing. You're shot down the tubes. If you know, flushed, you know. If you know that you're a dummy, you're like crap. You are a flush. But you believe because there's against hope, you believe in hope. I mean, you know, I just have this sense from God the Father that is so beautiful in him, and yet we're at our worst at that moment. It's so funny because when we're at our best, it is like slimy, you know, that leprosy just sliming everything up when we're at our best. When we're at our worst, but we're holding on to the grace of God, he says, that's beautiful. I just think it is so cool because you ain't going to figure this one out. You're just going to have to walk and know the Lord and keep on going.
So actually,
kind of
that with the prodigal son, when the prodigal like saw what a jerk he was and how gross everything, that it took some sort of faith for him to even start walking home, because he would have said, I'm not worthy and God's not going to take me out, I'm going to go home. And he was, I don't think he was sure about how the father was going to receive him, but at least he went home.
Okay, so where we got to this point was we were saying that only the living word can fulfill the written word. If we do separate ourselves from Jesus, we go try to get into the word and get right instead of getting into the word and know Jesus. So it takes Jesus to fulfill the scriptures. It takes Jesus. So don't separate yourself from Jesus. Until Jesus comes forth, the scriptures are not fulfilled. You might have kept some, but you haven't fulfilled. You might have kept a lot of it if you break the one. Break it all. You know, I really don't think too many Christians really realize what that means. I really don't. If you break one, you broke them all. Not if you break one, then that breaks the link. It's like it breaks every link. You broke them all. I know you don't understand that, but it's the difference between keeping and fulfilling. If you kept all these and you broke that one, then you just broke that one because you didn't keep it. But if this thing is a fulfiller and you kept all this and you broke this one, this is proof that you're not any of these. And so you're not the fulfillment. Christ is the fulfillment.
possible for somebody to finally stand before God having fulfilled everything in the law.
Or kept.
Or kept everything that was in the law. They could not compare themselves to Jesus to be equal.
Right.
Because there would be no comparison, because that's how God makes it. It's not comparison, but that's how God, that's his righteousness. That's what he wants.
Christ is what he always wanted.
And
he's a complete thought and concept. And being perfect apart from Christ is perfect.
And the other thing the Lord showed me is that even if they were to keep all the letter of the law, then they would be fulfilling the promises of the devil. He would be a God.
Well, I don't want to be like the devil, so I'm going to search the scriptures for Christ. Good stuff. Praise God. We're throwing a lot of stuff out here, and I realize, I hope you're not sitting there hoping that you understand everything that's being said. And then realizing that you probably don't, therefore you must not be of God or something. Okay, well, you're not. The Word is with God, and you're in Christ, so you're with God. Definitely. But keep being separate. No, I ain't getting this, so you're in Christ, you're one with him, you're his son. Just keep on going. Just because your mind doesn't comprehend doesn't mean the truth isn't the truth. It doesn't mean your spirit isn't what it's supposed to be. The scriptures were incomplete until Christ filled them fully. The scriptures are incomplete. And this is where you get Romans, where it says the law was weak through the flesh, but Jesus came and fulfilled. The scriptures are not, I mean, the law is good and just, and we're carnal, but the law may be good and just and all that it says, but it is not complete without Christ. Christ is the fulfillment of the scriptures. He doesn't even come and fulfill the scriptures. He is the fulfillment. We just don't understand. Jesus doesn't just come and fulfill the scriptures. The scriptures are the big standard, and I must meet them. And once I meet them, I'll be the big standard. No. He is the fulfillment of what they were even written for. You know, the example I always give is that, Deb's got, Cassie in her bedroom on her wall has got all these pictures of all these young guys, the most handsome, all these popular young guys, Brad Pitt and everybody else up there. So she was telling me the other day, she said Deb was in there, and they were talking, and she said, well, what do you think? Mom, what do you think? A good looking guy. What do you like? So she says, well, I'll tell you what I like. I like light blue eyes. I like kind of silvery brown hair. I like mustache. And I like kind of a thinner frame and da-da-da-da. And she went on and on and on and dressed her. You're talking about Dad. And she said, because you can mark somebody up there with silver hair, blue eyes, thinner frame, da-da-da-da. And she looked at her and goes, sorry, that ain't it. What do you mean? I got blue eyes. But you're still not it. I fulfilled. No. You kept some of the things, but you're not the fulfillment. And now walk in the room, she goes, there's the fulfillment. Do you understand? That's what the scriptures are. Written down, blue eyes, thinner frame. They're just a written description of the way Jesus is. Loves his neighbor, all this time. And so we go try to act like Jesus by reading that and trying to be that. And Jesus walks in and says, I'm in. I'm the fulfillment of the scriptures. I'm the fulfillment of everything. And we go, well, good. Get over here and help me fulfill it. He goes, you can't fulfill. I'm the fulfillment. Did you hear what I said? I'm the fulfillment. Well, good. Help me keep it. If you kept it, you would still be unacceptable. I thought the law was everything. No. The law was just written up there. You know where the law came from? Moses went up into the mountain. spend time with God, and he's talking with God, and he's fellowshipping with God. He comes down, and his face is glowing because he's been in the presence of God. He's talked face to face with God. He comes down to talk to the people. They see his face glowing. It scares them. Ah! Put a veil over your face, and whatever God tells us to do, we'll do it. Okay, here's the law. But it was just Christ written down. Here's the way he is. He loves, he goes the extra mile, he blesses those who curse him, da da da. This is the way Jesus is. Everything that you everything that I want you to do, you'll do it. He said, look, Jesus wrote down the scriptures, handed it to Moses. Moses came down and said, okay, here it is. But the law was not the big thing that Jesus came and said, okay, I've got to measure up here somehow. He was the fulfillment, and he never looked at the law. He just walked around and blew eyes and everything, and all just was there. Everything, because he was in. That's the way he was. You know. You never really see Jesus running around, you know, going, oh, I better, you know, now, you know, if he says to fulfill all righteousness, I better, you know, do this, let it be so for now. But that's talking about as Son of Man, he came down and did those things. As a man, he walked as a man. But as Son of God, he was the fulfillment by his nature. You're going to talk about acts of nature. His nature was and is. And is to come and is ever will be. He is Alpha and Omega. The only difference between the beginning and the end is we got in him and he got in us. You say, well, we did a real good work for you too. No, you didn't. You yielded to him. His life came forth, his life brings forth fruit, and some stuff happened. If you're going to pat yourself on the back for that, then you don't understand who did it. In fact, there won't be any rewards for that because you see what I'm saying? I mean, it's either Christ or it's not Christ. If it's not Christ, I don't care how sincere you are. You say, that guy's a murderer. That's not Christ. Well, you're not Christ either. Just both as far can be, well, I'll be better. Well, good. Now you're a good Adam. Before you were a bad Adam. Still in Jesus. God wants his son, and God is making sons by Christ. And you are a son of God when you receive Christ. So we say, John says this, John is way ahead now, 1 John chapter 3, he says, beloved, now are you the sons of God. Okay, so his first word out of his mouth, beloved. Huh? What are you talking about? Now are you the sons of God. It does not yet appear. It does not yet appear. You are a son of God because you received the seed. He's the fulfillment. Is he fulfilling it all through you at this point? No. Can he eventually? Sure, because he is the fulfillment. But it doesn't yet appear. More and more it's appearing, but it does not yet appear when you shall be. But I'll tell you how you'll know. When he appears, you'll be like him. Didn't say when he appears, you better be like him. Or you better act like him, or look busy because Jesus is coming or something. Is you, because you're one with him, he is your fulfillment. He's my wisdom. He's my righteousness. He is love. He's my peace. He's my hope. The scriptures say he is all these things to us. To us. That's why it says he is these things. Like we're going, oh, I don't feel any peace. My emotions, I'm upset. Oh, God, give me peace. Give me peace. I need some peace. Oh, and the devil's just riding. Oh, I'd love to get him panicked like this, throws a saddle on your back, goes, ah! You know? And he says, I'm your peace, I'm your peace. Well, I don't feel it, I don't feel it. That's because that's your most wrong realm. Come on, get over here with me. Ah, I'm in it. Yeah, where's God? Where's God? Totally off. We're in our little world, in our little realm, in our little life, and we're trying to get him. We're trying to take that's like being under the table and scrapping for the the crumbs and stuff, and then reaching up and grabbing God and pulling his face down into the slop that's falling down there with us and kind of look at this and shoving his face into all the garbage that we're into down there. He's going, look, you know, I don't care what's under the table. You're down here with the dogs that sit over there in the corner, and they're all down here, and they're licking and throwing up and chucking. You're down here rolling in it. Get up here with me. But we're trying to grab him and shove his face in. You apparently don't see this. Get out here. Or get his face into the middle of it. Look at him. How does this work? You want to understand the ins and outs of vomit? Dog vomit, is that what you would like? A good explanation of dog vomit? You know, this isn't up here on top of the table where me and my son sit. We don't really deal a lot with this. We get up on the table, tell the servants to clean out from under the table, go feed the dogs, take them out, clear away the table. But I'm your Father, I'm your Lord, I love you, so I'll get down here in the slop. I'll never leave you or forsake you. So he doesn't. So we say, we assume that's the way, that's Christianity. What, you know, and so we get a testimony. Well, one time I was in the slop, I pulled God's face right smack into it. You know, God moved me. And everybody goes, whoa, man, that's the way I like to live. Pulling God into all my slop. And having him get out. And then it just spreads and spreads and spreads. And then the testimony of God is lost for the testimony of what God did for you, because it's the furthest end of his compassion apart from the work of his son. But he is compassionate. He has to get down there with him. But he would rather somebody say, man, I've sat at the table with you, I've supped with you, I've partaken, I've shared face to face in that glow like Moses had me there, and everybody like, go, put a veil over there, just tell us what you want, we'll do it. You know? But rather than go, man, you were with the Lord, we could approach God like that. You talk face to face. You were the friend of God. And run up the hill. Oh, everybody's afraid. He says, you know, we're made in his image, even though we're fallen. So pitiful. Well, I mean, we're made in his image. He really is really rather like us. He really is. He's, you know, if you take the best picture of a loving father, and then, you know, if you, being evil, know how to give good gifts unto you, how much more this guy called the Father is just unbelievably beautiful and wonderful. How can we know that? We're not looking at his face, you know, we're looking at his hands. Get those hands down. Remember, I wrote a book called Knowing God, you know, Seeking God for His Hands or His Face. You know what I mean? We're not seeking to see his face. Well, what's in his face? The light of the knowledge of the glory of God. But we want his hands. Well, get your hands down. Reach your hands down here into my little world, my life, my situation. And he says, I've raised you up. We say, come down, Lord Jesus. Come back for us, rapture. Come down to get us up. And he says, I already raised you up. You're one with me. Seated in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. I'm the one that's in you down there. You're in me. Your life is him. When I appear, that's you. Then shall you appear. Look, it's me in Jesus. When you see Jesus, you know, that's what it says. This is like a mirror. That's what the New Testament says. This is like a mirror. But you know what? You don't really see your face. You see Jesus. But it's like a mirror. It says that, see? Which is contrary to a mirror. But it's like a mirror. And you look, and you see Jesus, and it says as you look into the glass, it's called, the looking glass, the mirror, as you look, you are changed from glory to glory, because you look and you see Jesus, and you go, I see Jesus here, not me. You go, I'm in Jesus. I'm one with Jesus. That's me. You don't go, oh, he's Mr. Oyster, he's going to ride. I can't take it off the trip. Put a veil over it. I hate to hear preachers preach like this. Put a veil over it, brother. Put a sock in it. That's the dude. I hate to hear this now because it makes me feel bad about where I'm at. My God, where are you? You are in the most glorious place you could be. God puts you in the most. I was thinking about that a while ago when I was the last class I was teaching. I said, you know, people go into the sanctuary and the scripture talks about being in the sanctuary. You know what the sanctuary is? The sanctuary is in Christ. It is. The sanctuary, it is a place. The name of the Lord is like a strong tower. The righteous run into it and are safe. To be in Him is sanctuary. It is to go in Him and identify. I am accepted in Him. There's rest. There's sanctuary. There's peace in here. In Him. You get out of here apart from Him, not in Him, not identified with Him, just being for Him, there's no sanctuary. You can go in any building. You might feel some peace because I believe in our sanctuary over there, people have walked in felt peace in their emotions and feel a peace from God. But that's not the peace God wants you to have. Christ is your peace, and when you get in Him, there is sanctuary. And until you have been assailed in the night, running through the streets with the darkness all around and the hounds chasing and nipping at your feet, you're not ever going to appreciate sanctuary. I mean, I don't know that it has to be that bad, but in one sense it does, because that's the old nature, that's the enemy, that's the way life truly should be seen apart from Christ. But until that, you're never going to walk in Christ, fall down and go, yes, 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 yes. I will never retreat out of here. You know, they had cities of refuge. That was also a picture of Christ. Where if you had killed somebody or done something wrong, God set up all over Israel cities of refuge. This is in the Old Testament. And you could run to those cities of refuge. And once you got in there, they couldn't come kill you. You were safe. And you could find peace. And you didn't have to look over your shoulder every time you went to another house. But you had to stay in that city. And there was a couple of people who got out. And they got killed. Because you got to stay, you got to what we call abide or dwell. You got to dwell, not just visit the sanctuary. You know, I will dwell in the hot house of the Lord forever. I will abide in the house of the Lord forever. I won't just go visit. What's that? You don't even know. But, you know, so some of you sit there and go, my God, am I going to have to move in with Alan and Lucy? I ain't even talking. They're talking about running into this city of refuge. And, you know, we say, well, when's God going to show me this stuff? Good grief. You know, it's obvious. You need to be left in the streets for a while. You need to be an orphan thrown into the streets and have all the terrors all around you. And then you come back and you are wide open to the truth. And I believe that there are people that have come here like that. I believe there are people yet to come here that have tried it. You know, Ricky said something like this the other day. He says, man, y'all pray for me. The devil's trying to get me out of here, and if I get out of here, he's going to kill me. City of refuge. But it's not new creation, although new creation is a physical manifestation of the spiritual truth. It is. But it's the spiritual reality that if you leave here, you're unconnected. You don't have that connection with it. It's not us. It's not the place. And if you I understand that. If I get outside of Christ for a moment, who can answer the law? Who can answer the great finger of the law that has the demand? Who can meet those demands? Man, I can't even. I just can't think about it. Oh God, this is killing me. This ship in the head or whatever. I can't do it. I just don't have it in me. I have it in. They want to try, you know, and when he shows, that's why, you know, I mean, I'm laying there, there's a heap of nothing, and he said, and he opens the door to the sanctuary to me and says, come in. I ran in. The name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous run into it and are safe, because not because you're righteous you run into it, but in there, he has made a new righteousness, and you go, this is my righteousness. You are my righteousness. You are my peace. You are my hope. And I am one with you. You said it, heard, I mean, this is, you know, I'm mainly saying this for me. You said I'm in Christ, of God or either God. You put me in Christ. If I'm so evil and yucky and whatever, that's your fault and you're dumb and you should suffer for it, but you put me in Christ. He goes, I know, because before I did it, I took you through the cross and you're dead. You just haven't realized it, but you still act like the old nature, but you're dead. Christ is. You're not. The Word was. The earth was without form.
I was wondering a number of times the statement that God needs to show you what you really are, and that never made any sense to me, because if God was showing us what we really are, that's what the Word is for. But what God is doing is showing us what we're identifying with, and He's not showing. And so, because when we really get a good vision of what we're identifying with, then we can start seeing what God wants us and desires us to be identified with.
Amen. Well, see, it's that Old Testament mentality. If you're not in Christ, then you feel guilty. You should feel guilty because you're guilty. But in Christ, Jesus paid it all. And because you won't accept it, you're guilty. Yeah. I was witnessing somebody, and they said, well, you know, I don't think it's right that Jesus should die for us. I mean, it's our fault. God should have killed him. God didn't kill him. He laid down his life. He did it willingly for you. If you don't accept it, you're just a big dummy here. You know. But you see what I mean? I mean, our minds are so weird. Well, I wouldn't want to. I mean, that's like taking advantage. No, it's like you're not taking advantage of what He freely gave you. And you're making void the grace of God. He died for you, now you're going to have to die for you. If He's going to give it to me, okay. You know? And then after a while, I mean, it is like, you know, it's like you grow up with a father that, you know, he acts like he's going to give you something and he hits you. You know, you're sitting there laughing and all the stuff to get you. But all the time you're used to getting hit all the time. So you meet God, and at first it's like He's offering you this, and you know you're not worthy, and you don't have, you know, and you go, okay, I'll take it, you know, but you're kind of going like this, ready to be hit upside the head, and you receive it, and He doesn't hit you, and you're, you know, and so for a while, you do have to kind of, you're ready to be slapped down, but folks, after a while, good grief, but it shouldn't be 20 years later that you're still going, sooner or later you're going to go, you know, you've consistently been faithful and not hit me, you know, and maybe a good question like this, why? He'd say, Jesus died already for it all, I ain't ever going to hit you. He bore your stripes. And you go, then, but see, I mean, even just the consistency that they hadn't done it, sooner or later, you got to go wake up and go, dang, this is different. Not just keep on going forever. Oh, no, man. I'm full of beard. I think I'm supposed to stay full of beard. But you never know. I mean, I know it's been 20 years with you, Lord, but you'll probably turn on me in an instant. Give them the right opportunity. You just haven't had the right one yet. What I am and what you think I do, two different things. Your view of me ain't me. And you spent 20 years dodging and holding yourself in just such a way that if the swing comes, you can run away and not get hurt. You spent all that time doing that when you should have been using all that energy of crouching and moving up slowly and all that, just to know what I was really like, and you'd have figured you'd have saved yourself a lot of time realizing you were never in a fear. I told you from the very day you got saved, on the first year, within the first year, you come forward to the throne of grace and see how the time did any chair. I told you my attitude is the way I am. You never believed. You always believed everything but me. And now you're wondering why you're all, you know, your life's messed up. you want to be it, da-da-da. And he'll say something like, in the beginning was the Word, but you didn't make the Word your beginning. He made your past, and you drove Babylon into Zion. Jeremiah told them to. You drove Babylon into Zion. You drove what is no longer into what is, when that should have been a clean break. I'm dead. My old is gone. And the last vestiges of it will soon flicker and fade away as I proceed into the light of the new day, the new dawn. Burn your bridges. Burn your bridges. No more issues, no more plans, no more nothing. This is it. Okay, here I go. Your word is my beginning. No, your word is the beginning. It was the beginning before I was. I just identified with it. That makes it mine. So here I come. You said, come home. Here I come. Now, if God starts slapping you around, the only problem is, sometimes you've been listening to the devil so long, if the devil slaps you around and then says, I'm God. Yeah. So, you know, what's God supposed to do? He sent his word, he sent his son, and his son died on the cross, he sent the Holy Spirit to teach us. I guess the devil's just smarter and greater. That's all I can say. The devil just must really be really bored. He is a created being. He can't be eternal. He's a created being. He can't be eternal. He's a failure anyway. He was originally an angel. He failed. He's a failure. Don't say that, brother. He's a failure! Scared of the devil. Jesus is bigger than he is. My father is bigger than he is. I am not scared of the devil. The devil is defeated. And if there's any area in my life or around me that he thinks he's getting away with something, Jesus Christ is Lord and will show himself strong. And I believe that, and that's my faith stand, and I have not backed off on that ever. And I just got the opportunity over a few years to see it manifested over and over and over and over and over, because I'm one with the Lord. I'm out of his rib. A man, the church, the bride, we came out of his side. Where do you think we came from? We're no longer some harlot off the street. He put him to death and then brought us out of that death. The bride is bone of his bone. It ain't the old bones that he breathed on and did something. The bride is something new. It was one with him. It ain't old, dirty, filthy, harlot material. That was, don't you understand, that's what the cross removed. And now all things are new, and he was wounded for us, and the bride was taken out of him, and we were created from his substance. We are one with him. We are, the bride is one with him. Because he's the one from which we are. But we're still in the old, on the other side of the cross, still trying to get God to help us and bless us and get us closer to him and just teach me enough so I can act right or something. I don't know. You know what I mean? Let me tell you. I know what has to take place. Lazarus was in that tomb. He died. He died. He died. He didn't. In fact, he died. He died. And Jesus, just to make sure that he'd get the point, left him in there for 3 days till he stunk. He was decaying. You know, so that, you know, people would go, well, he really just kind of fell asleep for a little while. He had a sleeping attack or something. He was narcoleptic or something. But instead, he said, Lazarus, come forth. At his word, he came forth. But Lazarus came forth like this. Did you know that? Why did he come forth like that? Why did he come forth going, yeah, baby! said, somebody take them grave clothes off. Jesus didn't take his grave clothes off. And it's kind of interesting that Lazarus didn't take them off either. Somebody else started speaking the words, started sharing, started ministering, started saying, look, this is the old, you know, I'm not a minister, I'm not this, or that. I don't know what, learn the word, and just speak the word, just be a son of God. Everybody here, just be a son of God. Just be a son of God. Don't be a minister, don't be a missionary, don't strive to be anything but a son of God. Don't take a lower seat by trying to be something else. Be a son of God. And a son of God will speak for his father, will speak for his father's kingdom. You know, God had a kingdom. He set people in charge of it. They were people. They weren't his son. So what are they going to do? The fruit starts coming forth. It's the father's vineyard. The fruit starts coming forth. And so they pretty soon start getting all the benefits of it. You know, we're getting the fruit of this whole thing. But they're not changed because they're not sons. So they begin to go, well, this is our vineyard. And we ain't going to send any more of this fruit back to the father. Give him the glory. Send him, give him the honor, do him. We're going to keep this for ourselves. So we sent a servant. That servant says, I'm going to kill him or beat him up. Send him away, I sent another servant. So finally, the father sent his son. Because the son is going to go, look, I speak on behalf of my father. What you see is the emanation of the father. It's not just a messenger. It's not just a, I am the express image of the father. I am his son. He didn't go, look, I have a badge here. I've got authority because I'm in authority. You know, this is the truth. And I believe, you know that I believe in spiritual authority and all that stuff. I do. I believe in that. But I tell you what, you ain't never going to manifest proper authority until you're a son of God. You know? That's right. You will abuse that authority. Those servants abused their authority, took over the vineyard, and began to say the fruit is ours. The son came, and he said, look, man, all this belongs to the father. What do you think he's going to say? He's going to talk to the father. He's going to say it's of another kingdom. I'm here on his behalf. You know? And when you begin to speak as one that has been with the father, one that views things from the Father's viewpoint. You know, well, it is the rules around here that we pick up the trash. Oh, great. Well, let's just make everybody just hire them. You know what I mean? It's the rules here that we, okay, well, good. Thank God we, you know, it's good to have rules. But the truth is, I'd rather not have any rules in any place. I'd just rather have some. That's what I want. I just want the sons of God. Because the Son of God will do what he does for the glory of the Father, if somebody's watching or not watching. A son of God will minister to a person and start getting their grave clothes off of them. Because it's the Spirit of Christ to do that. You know? A son of God will always have the right spirit, will always, because he's not doing it for himself. There's not a motivation, well, I think I'll come down here and become king of kings and lord of lords. The Bible says, Jesus, let this mind be in you that was also in Christ Jesus, who became a servant, became in the likeness of man, came down here, put on flesh, this is the eternal Son of God, the one who never knew weakness or hurt or anything. Come down here, not only came down here, but became a servant, began to serve everybody, but that was the spirit that was in him, his nature. Served the blessed to minister and everything because he's the Son of God, and lifted up the Father. Father, I have accomplished what you sent me to do. I've glorified your name. That's my greatest joy. I've lifted you up. I've finished the ministry. Then became obedient unto death, and then it says, for this cause, God the Father hath highly exalted him and given him a name which is above every name, that in the name of Jesus every knee shall bow, whether things of heaven or earth or under the earth, and every tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. Okay. Jesus didn't come down here to do this right, Mr. start a little bit so that he can get a little recognition, so he can be exalted. You know what I mean? Do you understand what I mean? He's not kind of going, okay, now, well, okay. If down is up, then I'll be down for as long as I get up. You know, if serving will get me recognized, you know, you can't be a good leader till you serve. Well, I'll serve for a while. You'll be serving forever. You will be a servant. The kingdom is the king. He's greatest in the kingdom, serving all. A-L-L. I want to be great. Good. Serve everybody. Everybody. Just serve them. Just get there, find out what they need. Minister. What is it you need? Oh, I want to be a great one. And you don't want to be what you want to be. You know what I mean? Because his spirit is other than us. And so, but we're, you know, figuring, we're, you know, well, now we've got, we need these rules, and you need to follow this rule and everything. And I'm saying, it ain't, you know, if everybody here kept all the rules, you ain't what God wants. As a leader here, the goal is not just to keep people in rules, the goal is to teach them Christ. Now, here's the deal. You know, the reason why we do this isn't just because it's a rule that Randy said 3 years ago, and bless God, we're going to do it, because Randy's the authority, and we obey, and we believe in spiritual authority. No, let me tell you, there's a spiritual reason behind everything that we do. There is a reason. You know, somebody says, well, bless God, why do the girls have a shower schedule, and the guys have a shower schedule, and when I want a shower, it's during the girls' shower schedule, I can't get a shower. What is the deal? You don't say, well, bless God, that's the way the rules are set up. You can go with it or no. You can walk if you want. You can walk. But you say, look, let me tell you, everything is designed that we can serve one another. This is an opportunity to lay down our life and to put others first, that Christ may be glorified in all things. This is not, no, you know, if this freaks you out and to put this on you really just blows you away and makes you leave God, you know, and offends you to a degree that you'll leave here when you need this place, then guess what? Get in there and get you a shower, baby. If that'll hold you a little longer till we can pump the word in you, then the schedule can go to hell. Get in there. Hello? But then when you look and the majority are wanting to bend the rules for their own selfish life, then you close the whole thing. You take a few disciples of God and go off. And sit down and you start to stretch. Right. You test the water. You test the, you get a little litmus test. If it's mostly flesh and it just seems, you know, that the whole thing, you go, we missed the point here. Let's start over. Let's see if we can get it right this time. Okay, now the goal is Christ. Christ is the fulfillment of everything. It has nothing to do with buildings and rules and places or whatever. You see what I'm saying? Christ. In the beginning was the Word. The Word was made flesh. That's our goal. Get in and the living Word begin to live through us. And we not be us, the demonstrations of Christ. Jesus said, Jesus was the express image of the Father. I came to glorify the Father. I do not speak of myself. I do not, and he says, I am your temple. Okay, what that means is we come, we glorify Jesus, because the head of every man is Jesus, the head of Jesus is the Father. He glorified the fruit, but he's our head. We glorify him. I don't do my own works. Don't do that. I won't do that. See, I keep control of my life. You say, well, it's a good thing you stopped yourself from doing that sin. Oh, my God, we sit there and do all kinds of stuff to that Jesus. And it's not even a guilty sin. We need to get a hold of ourselves and go, I need to know Jesus. You say, well, okay, don't do nothing. Just sit here and be a bump on the wall until Jesus comes. No, get after knowing Jesus. Lock yourself away, man. I mean, I remember I'd hear the Word go forth like that, and I'd go, my God, I ain't got any business. Right now, I just need to soak in the Word. Thank God I wasn't firm enough in the ministry where if I dropped out, I'd knock everything in turmoil.
was just a little nobody in the Bible school. It wasn't a situation where I just dropped out and then threw everything in a mess because everybody was dependent on everybody. And it was early enough where I got in there and said, man, I need the Lord. And so everybody would leave the classroom and I would sit there and just search the scriptures and cry and cry. And then I'd just cry. I want to know you. I don't know you. I'm under conviction. I need you desperately. You know, I didn't let the moment pass because you walk out of here and you get to talking and stuff like that. And, you know, it's gone. You know what I'm talking about. I didn't let the moment. I didn't take it lightly. Well, they'll get it. God, we got Randy, and we know he's going to be preaching this way, so it's going to affect me. It's probably going to really get to me eventually. And I said, no, I will not. And I just stayed that. I didn't want to move. The Spirit of God was on me. The Spirit of God was dealing with me. And I said, I need to stay under this. It almost felt like a covering of a sheet over me, where I was with the Lord at that moment. And I didn't want to lightly throw it on, okay, what's going on with you? You know, I just pulled it over and said, you know, people come out and go, I'm really good. I just really need the Lord. I mean, if you would do anything, would you just pray for me right now? Would you pray for me? That's a lie. I just need to spend some time with the Lord. And I just said, I don't want to lose this, man. I don't feel this way all the time. In fact, it seems to be, you know, a lot where it's just me, and then all of a sudden I have this desire from the Word, the sharing of the Word or something that's really affecting me, and I don't want to just take this lightly. I want to grasp it. I want to be in the Word now because, I don't know, I did begin to see the Lord better at those times. And if I didn't see them, my prayers were better. They said what I really felt deep in my heart, you know. Because after I walk out and I get to talk to everybody, do all my thing, and go on there, then and I said, well, I've got to pray. And, you know, I haven't really prayed in a couple of weeks. You know, I guess I better pray. And I'm not in tune with the Lord. I'm not under that covering. I'm not dealt with. And so I go, oh, Lord, let's see. We got that outreach coming up. Lord, you just bless that thing. And I remember so-and-so mentioned in church. You know, I mean, there's not that what's really in your heart. And so you don't feel fulfilled when you pray. You know, but when you're there under that covering and under that healing, you say, or even if you can't say it, you just start praying in tongues, you know it's said. Oh Lord, I don't know you. I need you so bad. I need you to reveal your son in me. I am desperate. I am not what I think I am. I am not big. I am not smart. I am not wise. I need you. And you know what it is? They that humble themselves, he looks on. The day that this comes back. Christianity is about trying to get this feeling every so often and then walking off from it. That's Christianity. What we want to do is extend the length of time we have that feeling. Well, we don't do anything when that is the Lord feeling. It's the presence of God. But we don't do anything with it when we have it. See what I'm saying? I mean, we have it. And then we break it. Does anybody agree with me? I mean, I really think if we break it, God, I don't think God just kind of lived. Now, what will happen is, and this has happened to me, I sat there 5 minutes in the presence of the Lord. And then all of a sudden the Lord kind of said, I squeezed what I needed to out of it. And it was just 5 minutes. You know, I thought it could have been 2 hours or whatever. I mean, I didn't know. It was just 5 minutes. But there was a sense of, okay, you know, it's like, it wasn't like just like, it's all over with as much as I've read the Word, I've come to a certain juncture, and it's time to get up. It's kind of time to, you know. And then I've had a few times when I'm sitting there and I want the Lord so bad. And the Lord shows me a need outside the door. They're carrying something out the back door. And I say, I don't want to be, I don't want this broken. I want you so bad, Lord. I don't want this broken. But if I get out there and help them, then I'm going to get all that different. And then I say, but I want your life. And it's not just moving with this feeling, but moving with your spirit. bring down your life to somebody else. Do you understand that? I mean, really, and you know what? I believe this. I believe God sees that. And I believe God says, that's my son. That's my son. And you don't have to worry about his son, because I'm going to see to it that when you do get into the Word, it's going to be for you. You're going to know my son. You're going to know the Christ that's within you that you're trying your best to go with. And you are so precious to me. And if you're laying down your life and you go through a season where you're just, all you can think of is, I want to be with the Lord, but these needs keep arising and you keep laying down your life. If you get 5 minutes in the Word, I will so think you've got done that. Where I just didn't, you know. And then there comes a time when he says, okay, that's enough. Now I want you to go and get into the Word. And you do that. And then sometimes it is, I want you into the Word now. It's not our little tricks playing self-justification or whatever. It's here from God. I want you in the Word. I don't want you to go over there and help. And it kills you because you want to get up and go over there and help. You're not just going, oh, praise God. No, I'm with the Lord self-justifying and all this junk. It's killing you, see, It's killing you to not get up and go, Lord, this is hard because you put your spirit in me and your spirit wants to serve and to bless. And he says, I really want you to fellowship with me. Some people say, Randy, why do you run off and hide on Mondays and not spend time with God? I'm going to keep my appointment with God. He's more important than anybody else I meet with. I just got an appointment. And so I keep my appointment with the Lord. That's all it is. I very seldom break my appointment to keep God. I keep them. Well, there's tragic things going on. Well, that's why God's out there, and that's why there's a body and everything. How can you lay there? There have been cases where I felt, man, I need to get up and go because to serve and whatever. And the Lord says, no. Right now, you need to spend time with me. There's never a justification. You see what I'm saying? It's never those little tricks we play to, get out of something, or to look spiritual, or to, to justify whether they think I'm not spiritual because I'm not coming to help. I know that I'm spending time with God. No, God, yeah, spending time with God, unless you're God. Jesus said this parable. The Pharisee and the publican went in to pray. The sinner fell down and said, oh, God, I'm not even worthy of being heard. And it says in the Pharisee prayed thus within himself, oh, God. He wasn't praying to God. He prayed thus within himself.